wonders.
I don't know. Wow, 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 wow. Welcome to the new season and new episode of the new season of Hanna Wonders. Welcome back to those of you who have been so kind to tune in for the last few episodes. I know it's been a while, but I've been learning so much, and I wanted to make sure that I came into the new season with lots of fun new ways to tell you guys all about theater history and the shows that we love. So I'm really excited to start this season. My goal in this season is to push myself as a dramaturg, and that means making a lot more social comparisons and historical comparisons. So I hope you're along for this ride. But I, for those of you that don't know who I am or what I do, my name is Hanna, and I love to wonder about things, mostly theater related, because I am a self-proclaimed theater nerd. So I decided to pick something that I thought would be inspiring to me, and I wanted to pick a show that just makes me feel hope and reaches that dark corner of my emo side while also having touched on Disney and one of my favorite novelists of all time. So, of course, I picked The Hunchback of Notre Dame. And of course, that means we're traveling back to Paris. I know that was where we last were, but since we just visited for the Bohemian era of Paris, I thought we'd just make it really dark and take it back to medieval times, because who doesn't want to revisit France in the medieval period? The Middle Ages were such a fascinating time to me, and when you're looking at a piece that has crossed so many centuries between when it was written, the time period it was written about, and then, of course, the times that it was produced, which was over a variety of decades, we have so much material and so many things to look at. So here we go. So the source material. People might not know the name, but they definitely know this person from his works. Victor Hugo was the person who wrote the original Hunchback of Notre Dame. Of course, at the time, it wasn't called that, but we'll get to that. Victor Hugo is most well known for writing on the source material for one of my other favorite musicals, Les Miserables. And he often was somebody that he wrote about the things that he saw and wanted to draw attention to politically and sociologically. He also gave the best namesake to my parents' beautiful long-haired German shepherd, Mr. Hugo. So there's always that. Because, you know, honestly, I think our dog is cooler, but that's because dogs are better than people. Victor Hugo was a native of France. He was born in 1802 and lived with his mother and two brothers while his dad lived in Italy. His dad was a general in the army. And as we'll go through this, you'll see that France went through quite a period of warfare and turmoil within the army. So that was a really big deal, and a lot of people experienced that. But in 1829, he began writing an ode to Gothic architecture. What a nerd. I mean, I'm just saying, like, I know I have a podcast about theater, but this is a guy who decided to write a novel to save and show the brilliance of a type of architecture, which is just a new level of nerd for me. He was really upset at the time because so many classic pieces of this building style were aging and falling apart and were even being destroyed around him in France. So he decided to write about Notre Dame. If right off the bat you can't picture Gothic architecture and you're not already in the Disney frame of mind for what the Hunchback of Notre Dame looks like, picture flying buttresses, which, yes, that's a real word, but vaulted ceilings, gargoyles. This design style was formed as a way to put the awe of God and the church into anyone who saw it. So we begin seeing cathedrals like Notre Dame that are built with a design that actually from an aerial view looks like a church. Or sorry, well, duh, it looks like a church that looks like a cross. And so you would have the altar would be the head of the cross, where people would enter in would be like the base going towards the top. And then it would have this pass through that went from side to side of the cathedral. And from an aerial view, it looked like a cross. And the entire point of this was that Christianity at the time was everything. Religion had this huge impact on life during this time period when Gothic architecture was created. So what they wanted was for people to enter and feel that impressive feeling, the awesome power of God. And so the cathedrals were really tall and they were just so impressive. Stained glass started to become more and more important as these were built. The sculptures, the work of cement around the cathedral was just becoming so detailed. And all of it was to show how impressive the religion and the power of God could be. What I didn't realize until researching this musical is that in the original novel, the main character isn't Quasimodo or Esmeralda, but was in fact the church itself. The story was meant to speak to many different political issues of the time, and so he used the church as almost this creature that was looking out onto the world around it. And as we see Quasimodo's character develop over the course of this story and onto the stage play later on, what we see is Quasimodo kind of starts to take on that piece of looking over a city but not being able to impact it or participate with it. But many historians believe that this piece of literature had much to do with the revitalization of Gothic pieces all over Europe. And this is something I consistently saw across my research, is that once Victor Hugo produced this work, which was originally titled Notre Dame de Paris, which literally translates to Notre Dame of Paris, it was so well liked. It really imbued this sense of importance to these works of architecture. And so people actually thank Victor Hugo for bringing the desecration of these sites to light and then attempting to prevent people from letting it happen. The novel was released in its original French in 1831 and then in English in 1833. But Hugo hated the release in English because they changed the title from the Notre Dame de Paris to the Hunchback of Notre Dame, which immediately takes us from thinking about the church to thinking about a character that lives within it. So he felt this made Quasimodo and his physical challenges the lead character of the novel, which was not his intention. Now, he wanted to write and he set the scene for his novel in 1482, which is the end of the Middle Ages. Hugo's work, like I said, often reflected his own frustrations with political and socioeconomic issues that he witnessed in his lifetime. Just like Les Mis was about the 1832 June Rebellion in Paris, which primarily addressed poverty among a litany of other issues, Hunchback is no different. Life in medieval times was tough for everyone. And I certainly covered a bit of that in Paris with the Moulin Rouge episode, but the medieval times were their own beast. While once we get into the 1800s where we looked at Moulin Rouge, that was kind of Paris coming into its own. It was becoming the epicenter of the arts and culture. It was the height of trade. When we're talking about 1482, everyone was suffering. Everyone had a difficult life. Of course, like the aristocrat, I said aristocrats. I'm so in Disney mode right now with the aristocrats that were operating. Of course, they didn't have it quite as bad, but labor was painstaking. The amount of work that it was to work in construction or in agriculture was so difficult that oftentimes people would end up with disabilities because of the work they were doing during this time period. Between the Hundred Years' War, which was just coming to a close at when Hugo's book takes place, and then, of course, the Black Plague, the city of Paris went through several periods of complete population desecration, where they, like, their numbers were cut in half from people dying, from people moving. So it was just a dirty, dark time in Paris. To understand where Victor Hugo wanted us to be for the setting of Hunchback, this was the most incredibly eye-opening note that I found. So this is describing the senses of being in Paris at this time. The streets of Paris were extremely noisy and very closed quarters. The preferred way of advertising for your business was shouting in the streets, which was later regulated, so you couldn't yell at someone that was eating next door or entering another business, but you would have people hawking their items. You had sellers who were selling different, textiles, meat, fish. They would stand outside and they would yell, "Come and see what we have in today. This is what we have fresh," etc. Official news and announcements were conveyed to the city of Paris by the Guild of Town Criers. And yes, this was the best job. I would have been so good at it. I just imagine myself just out there in the streets. 9 o'clock and all is well. 9 o'clock. You know, I would have been so good at it. I'm so obnoxious and I'm so loud. Like, it would have been fantastic. But that was how they conveyed news throughout the streets. And there were, it was a very exciting position to have. It was something that people really revered. If you were a town crier, it meant that you had a lot of trust with the government and with the aristocracy. So they would come out and they would tell everybody what was going on. But then at the same time, when it comes to, this is such a weird like transition, but the smells of Paris were awful. So in winter, you would smell wood burning or charcoal to heat homes or to cook. But year round, the streets smelled strongly of unwashed people, unwashed animals, human and animal waste. This was a time where chamber pots full of goodness were routinely disposed of through windows onto the streets below. I know we see that in like movies, but really think about it. That's my worst nightmare. That's just like, I don't even, first of all, how do you go in a chamber pot? Like the idea, I don't want to dive into this on a podcast, but like legitimately, it just is so bizarre to me that that we just threw it out on the streets, because I mean, what else do you do? And there were like very elementary type sewer systems, but really what they did is the streets would cave in the middle to allow stuff to run down it. That was like a very rudimentary system of it. So what I'm trying to tell you is Paris was gross. People worked really hard. They often hurt themselves or permanently disabled themselves working to provide for their families. The church had taken over. Christianity was at its peak. The Hundred Years' War had decimated the country along with the plague, which had just come through France and destroyed it. This is when leprosy was really common. This is a time when, the main dish or like main food of Parisians was bread, meat if they had more money. Fish was important because people wouldn't eat meat on the Sabbath, so it was important for them to have access to fish. But it was really difficult. Along with that, if you just needed water, most people, you couldn't drink out of the Seine River, which was the central point, because it was so disgusting. People just dumped like all kinds of animal byproducts, people byproducts, everything went in that river. So only very, very desperate people would drink out of the Seine, which meant that wealthy people had their own wells, and the townspeople traditionally would share fountains that were in the center of the city. And actually, you get a pretty good view of that in the Disney film. I'm not going to lie. I'm going to refer to it quite a bit, because even though it was super different than the original Hugo novel, they just spent a lot of time making it technically beautiful and giving a lot of those little details. So there is actually people going to a fountain in the middle and taking buckets to get water. That was how the townspeople, just your average Joe, would get their water. If this all wasn't pleasant enough, there was certainly a connection, as there always has been, between poverty and disability. Attitudes at the time about disabilities were mixed. Some thought that it was a punishment for sin or the sins of the father of the baby. We actually see that in the original novel of Hunchback. But there was no state provision at the time for people with disabilities. Many of these people afflicted were resorting to begging if they were unable to work. Many of them tried to push through work if they could possibly do it. Often those people became beggars who couldn't provide food for themselves, and they were, if they were lucky, looked after by monks and nuns, because at the time, those were the people who saw it kind of as their duty to assist them. As I said before, a lot of people developed disabilities from the nature of hard labor, and of course, hard labor tends to affect those who are poorer or who have works of trade. So blacksmiths, agriculturalists, so farmers. These are people who spend every day from morning until dusk just working, and they could create spinal and limb injuries, stunt their growth. They were often afflicted by malnutrition and just general deformities. So it wasn't even that they were born with them. A lot of people were affected in a way that you and I can't even understand in 2020, because our jobs were so protected by workers' comp and regulations like OSHA. Those are things that were put in place like many, many, many years after this to protect workers from creating a life where they couldn't provide for themselves anymore. And, you know, have your opinions about the healthcare today and, you know, being a worker in 2020 in the U.S. But in medieval times, there was nobody to catch you. There was no welfare. There wasn't a state-run program to protect anyone. And hospitals were just now becoming something that was accessible. Before then, it was always doctors. It was one-on-one. But this is when we start to see hospitals and asylums be created. So it was just interesting to think that, you know, these people were working themselves to the point where they could no longer work, and then they were at the mercy of the church, essentially, because they could no longer provide for themselves. There is historical evidence that the French had a habit of abusing the disabled in public for entertainment. And this isn't just France that is responsible for things like this. It was all over the place. But royalty indulged in this cruel entertainment by viewing disabled bodies for fun and hiring court jesters who often had hunchbacks, cerebral palsy, Down syndrome, or even epilepsy. These things were jokes to them, and it was meant for their entertainment. Dwarfs were highly sought after by medieval aristocrats. I did it again. By aristocrats. Oh my God. My paper even says aristocrats, and I just keep going back to the cute little amazing kitties. Anyways, so the court jesters often had hunchbacks, cerebral palsy, Down syndrome, or epilepsy. And because dwarfs were highly sought after, they were considered pets, and the wealthy saw them as a signifier of wealth. So they traded them, they purchased them. Sometimes dwarfs could be considered receiving a little bit better treatment. But honestly, at the time, what I read about the social impact at the time is that being extremely poor was just as difficult as being disabled at this time, because you were at the mercy of whoever could take care of you. Before I move on, I just want to mention that this is a theme that comes up a lot in the novel, and something I think about a lot in the work that I do day to day, and that is saviorism. Christianity began the idea that people with disabilities were not only defective, but needed to be saved. Considering many of the people afflicted with various frailties, it created a need for the wealthy, religious, and powerful to take care of them, creating the ability to control the person's life in exchange for basic needs. Charity placed on its recipients in a position of gratitude opened space for domination over those who were in need. This is something that we still experience every day, and it's something that I definitely want to go on a rant about later, but I will stay off of my soapbox for the moment. I just want you to keep in mind that for those that were at a disadvantage in this time period, there was nowhere to go. So if the church offered you a place to stay, you were under their bidding and you were going to do whatever was needed. So one last piece about the cathedral itself. The Cathedral of Notre Dame was built where it's believed the original Roman temple to Jupiter originally existed. And there were actually evidence of this when they dug up the original bones, so to speak, of Notre Dame, the first iteration of the cathedral. They found 12 stones that didn't match anything from the era, and it is believed that those were from the original architecture of the Roman temple, which I just think is really cool that these things are still around. The cathedral we know and love today is the work of Maurice de Sully, and he was the Bishop of Paris at the time. So the first stone was laid by Pope Alexander III, and the altar was consecrated in 1182. The facade was built between 1200 and 1225, and the two towers, I can't say that without thinking of Lord of the Rings, the two towers were built between 1225 and 1250. The church was finished in 1330, about 170 years after it was started. At the end, it was the largest monument in Paris, 125 meters long, and had the ability to seat 1,300 worshipers. It was, I mean, you talk about the awe of God. How could you walk into a building, especially in this time period, thinking of everything I just laid out for you? You think about walking into a place that is so big and well built and had taken 170 years to complete. That's going to make you feel religious. That's going to change your life. Okay, so we're going to fast forward to where Disney takes over. While there are many, many different retellings of Hugo's famous story, the most popular and also one of my top five favorite Disney movies is definitely Disney's retelling. There were several films that came out before this ever happened that were very Hollywood romanticized, but still semi-true to the original novel in the 30s and 40s. But it didn't really get popular attention until Disney took it over. So the film began production in 1993 and then was released in 1996. So it was a 3-year period. The development exec at the time was looking for something new and challenging to take on for the next big Disney hit. Can you imagine that pressure, by the way? You're just like, you're the Disney exec. You've worked your whole life. You have one of the top positions in entertainment, and you have to come up with new ideas to keep the public engaged. I mean, I know we all can have stressful things in our lives at work, but that is truly astounding to me. So the exec got together with directors Gary Truesdale and Kirk Wise, who had done Beauty and the Beast for Disney previously. Then they contact composer extraordinaire Alan Menken and lyricist Stephen Schwartz. If that name sounds familiar, it's because he's done all of the things, including Wicked, and he is one of my favorite composers when he does work like this. Now, I'm not a huge fan of his separate musicals, but that's for a different pod. Macon and Schwartz had already collaborated on Pocahontas together, so Disney was super confident that they would have an amazing partnership on this project. Macon actually said that of the songs and projects he's been a part of, the opening number, The Bells of Notre Dame, in this film, is his favorite. The film made so many changes. Oh my God, did it change everything? Of course, we expect that. I mean, Disney did Pocahontas. We know how they change things. But gird your loins, because this one, they changed a lot. Aside from its general dark tone, the original novel did not have a Disney ending, so they had to rework some things. First of all, instead of Esmeralda being the protagonist like she was in the novel, they shifted the focus to Quasimodo. Quasi, who was mute and deaf in the novel, was now, under Disney, able to speak and sing like an angel. The most changed character was actually Frollo, who, for those of you who haven't seen the movie in a while, is our villain. He takes the role of the judge in this. And instead of a beautiful and complex backstory, as every good villain should have, Disney turned him into a bit more one tone and kind of just made him into an overall butthead, using the church and his faith as an excuse to do the unimaginable. Of course, I was most shocked to find out that there weren't three gargoyles who sang and did card tricks and told jokes in the novel. So, you know, that's fine. I figured it was a long shot, but really it would have spiced up the 940 pages from the original's sad depressingness. I did warn you that the ending of the source material was not the happier Disney ending we all know and love. Instead of saving everyone and Frollo falling to his death, has Esmeralda being killed off by hanging, and Quasi is not so subtly pushes Frollo to his death. Following this, Quasi disappears and his skeleton is later discovered holding on to Esmeralda in her grave. Sweet. Creepy. Both. I'm going to say both. I don't know. It's kind of cute. I mean, I just kind of kept thinking, like, did he crawl in there like when he was on his way to dying? Or like, did he just crawl in there and like not leave? I don't know. That's where my head goes. Since I know I have some listeners who will say this movie is their absolute favorite Disney film, here are some fun tidbits. As far as actors go, this film ran the gamut. Jason Alexander, Jim Cummings, a Disney fave, Kevin Kline, and Demi Moore all took part of this piece, though a couple of them didn't sing for themselves. The budget for this film was $100 million and had a worldwide cumulative gross of $325.5 million. Due to its darker themes, the film nearly became the third Disney movie in history to receive a PG rating. It was actually the last movie until 2006 to say mild bad language, but then Cars came out, so. Since you all know how good I am with languages, I thought I would just attempt to teach myself how to pronounce things in German, so I hope your ears don't bleed, but we're going to now talk about the next step of this musical. So we've had the novel, couple of movies that didn't really make it big, then we have the Disney film. Now we're going to meet Der Glockner von Notre Dame. I have no idea if that was absolutely terrible. Please tell me. So while Macon and Schwartz were happy with their work on the Disney film, they still felt there was more to be done with the project. And instead of going the traditional Disney to Broadway route, they went to Germany. Disney parted with Stella Entertainment to produce The Hunchback of Notre Dame in the Musical Theater Berlin at Potsdamer Platz. Macon and Schwartz were determined to take the musical back to its darker source material, and they started by writing 9 new songs for the project. Then, one of my favorite guys, James Lapine, who was already known for his amazing work in Sunday in the Park with George and Into the Woods, came on as book writer for the project. The lyrics and script were written in English and then translated to German by a very prominent German lyricist and librettist named Michael Kuntz. This version of the stage production was definitely a return to its inspiration, a little bit closer. I mean, not 100%, but like a little nudge. Esmeralda's death was added back in. And the gargoyles became more maudlin, became more of a bigger chorus. And you could almost question whether or not the gargoyles lived in the Hunchback's imagination, or if it was like a vision that he was having instead of these characters that existed in the real world. Additionally, Quasimodo also got to murder Frollo at the end. So, I mean, if you're going to kill off Esmeralda, you have to at least let Quasi kill Frollo. This production was huge in scale. The cast was composed of 42 performers, most of whom were in the ensemble and chorus. Quasimodo had a crazy prosthetic to give the audience a visual of his, quote, deformities. The set, which was created by Heidi Ettinger, featured 11 automated hydraulic cubes that came up and down from the stage floor and created a variety of different set options and like geometric visuals. Jerome Sierlein set the scene and put the audience into Notre Dame with the use of projections. And I am such a sucker for projection. So this show, Der Glockner von Notre Dame, opened in June 5th, 1999. Featured choreography by Lar Lubavitch, costumes by Sue Blaine, lighting by Rick Fisher, and sound by Tony Miola. It ran for 3 years. How did I not know this? Anybody? Why am I just not hearing about this? That was ridiculous. 3 years. That's amazing. And it released a cast album in German, which I would like to get my hands on if anybody knows where I can find it. So this has a successful run, and then we come back to Disney, but not in a typical Disney Broadway fashion. We all know that Disney's taken over Broadway, and we know it wasn't always that way, where, you know, oh, Frozen came out, let's make a Frozen musical. Oh, you know, SpongeBob came out, well, that's Nickelodeon. You guys know what I'm talking about. It wasn't always like that, and it wasn't always as straightforward. So in the 2000s, Disney created a model that didn't just develop shows for Broadway, but also for regional licensing. So the idea was, we're going to create a show that regional theaters can license to produce. And that made it a lot more accessible than, you know, having a huge run on Broadway, which makes it a lot harder to then license those shows for smaller companies. Because of this new model of creating Disney shows, Schwartz, Menken, and longtime Disney producer Schumacher got another shot to perfect their show. They selected director Scott Schwartz, not to be confused with Steven, and they addressed him and said, "We want to strip the show down. We want to present it in a story theater format." So the idea behind story theater is that any theater can do it. High school to Broadway. It also means that the show would need to be stripped down, take away some of the set design, some of the like number of cast members needed, props, costumes, and make it more accessible. The original artistic crew on this project liked it because it would further return this piece to its darker roots and really strip down all of kind of the spectacle of it to make it more real, more authentic. To recreate this feeling, a lengthy prologue was added to the show to explain Frollo's backstory. So we really got to know a little bit more about him. And a new libretto was written by Peter Parnell, which rooted the lyrics in Hugo's writing. So he actually took excerpts from the original novel and mixed them up into the lyrics so that it was a lot closer to what we think Hugo would have appreciated. This production was titled The Hunchback of Notre Dame and was premiered as a co-production between La Jolla Playhouse in California and New Jersey's Paper Mill Playhouse. This format of the show has been professionally replicated and reproduced everywhere from Japan and Germany to La Mirada Theater for the Performing Arts, where it featured John McGinty, a deaf actor, as Quasimodo. If you only watch one YouTube video today after hearing this podcast, please, please go look up Out There with John McGinty. It is life-changing. The idea is that he's a deaf actor in real life, and he is signing while he has another person singing for him. And it is so real and so tangible. I don't even know how to describe it. The words don't even come to me, but it brings me to tears every time, because to see somebody who is actually getting to access this role as someone with a disability is so life-changing. And it's just like what Deaf West did with Spring Awakening. When you give people who have different experiences and who are built differently as humans the opportunity to be on stage, it changes the material and it gives you an opportunity to dive deeper and go in a different direction in some cases than you ever would have thought before. Why not? Why not, you know, cast Death of a Salesman with one of the sons in a wheelchair, you know, and let that drive the character. Let these human experiences, these real human experiences, change how you present the story to the audience. I'm off that soapbox, but seriously, John McGinty, out there, do it. At the very beginning of this podcast, I mentioned that what makes this experience so unique is that with a show like Hunchback, you're talking about source material and a story that takes place in 1482. That was originally in a novel that was written in 1831, that Disney released in 96, that was reworked in Germany in 99, and then came back to the States to complete this portion of its journey in 2014. We are stemming so many centuries of experiences and influence, and every one of these decades that this show was worked on had a direct impact on the show. Hunchback, the original cast recording from when they did it with Patrick Page and Michael Arden is available on Spotify. I highly recommend listening to Out There, God Help the Outcasts, and I love Heaven's Light. Those are three that I would really dive into if you just want to peek into the show a little bit. But this is definitely one of those shows that just has such a cool random history, and it really came from a Disney exec saying, we need something deeper, and here we go. So inspiration can come from anywhere, and I am very thankful that so many of Victor Hugo's works have lived on with the legacy that they have. Thank you so, so much for tuning in to this episode of Hanna Wonders. I am thrilled to be back, and I really hope you'll tune in next time as I get down and nerdy at Harvard with Ellen's. Oh my God, you guys, yes, it's Legally Blonde coming up next episode of Hanna Wonders, which will just be in a few weeks. So hold on to your panties. I hope you're all very excited. And if you have recommendations of things that you are desperate to hear about, please let me know. I will be presenting on a panel of dramaturgs this Saturday at the Phoenix Theater Company during their Festival of New American Theater. That is at 1:30 on Saturday at the Phoenix Theater Company. I will also be doing a presentation on Sunday about Agatha Christie and her works, and interviewing a playwright of a new work at the Phoenix Theater Company. If you are interested, I'm super excited because this is stuff I'm just doing on my own. It's not part of my job, but I'm actually starting to become a real dramaturg out in the world and not just in my bedroom with you guys. But you didn't know you were in my bedroom. So exciting. Yeah. So please come join me. I'm very excited about that. And I think that's it. I think that's all the things I'm doing right now, unless I'm forgetting stuff. Just a reminder, none of these musicals, none of these shows that I talk about happen without new work. So even though Hunchback had a very interesting kind of direction to take to become the musical that we know now, not many shows have that kind of opportunity with Disney as a launching point. Most shows start in someone's basement on a crappy computer, and it takes many, many, many sessions of rewrites and feedback to get to a place where you have the next Hamilton, the next Hadestown, the next Legally Blonde, et cetera, et cetera. yes, even Legally Blonde goes through tryouts. We'll hear about that next time. So please, if you're interested in new work, find your local New Works Festival. Check out what's coming up with local playwrights. It's important to give your feedback. It's important to give your money to arts organizations. Great. Yay. Thank you so much. And I hope you guys enjoyed this episode. I'll see you next time on Hanna.